Hi, it's Katrina. Today, the rules of physics are going to be broken. I'm going to be showing you some incredible ancient balancing rocks left by the gods themselves and statues that can fly.
The Levitating Statue of Alexandria. The Levitating Statue of Alexandria is only known in ancient legends. According to the myth, the statue was of Helios, the Greek god of the sun. His statue levitated above the temple floor of Alexandria's Serapeum complex. Ordinary people in the city had no idea how the hovering statue worked, but that shouldn't come as a huge surprise, considering plenty of people don't know how the cars they drive every single day work. Do you? You might. Scientists don't know how the ancient inventors in Alexandria could have pulled off a hovering statue. Maybe it was suspended magnetically using an ingenious invention. It's something experts could do today, if they felt like it. Plus, considering how many incredibly smart inventors lived in Alexandria, it's totally plausible that one of them came up with a way to make a statue float. The hero of Alexandria was one of the most brilliant Greek inventors. Even though he lived in Alexandria, it was during the Roman era, around the year 60 AD. He was Greek, not Egyptian, along with many people in Alexandria. The proper term would be Hellenized Egyptian. Ancient Egypt as we know it today had already ceased to exist with the death of Cleopatra, not even a century earlier. But I better stop myself before I spiral into an endless pit of historical facts. Anyway, the hero of Alexandria created devices powered by steam. He invented the earliest known windmill. He may have created far more amazing devices as well, but most of his original writings are lost. Only a handful of his works have been preserved in manuscripts from the Eastern Roman Empire, many of them translated to Arabic.
Could Hero have been responsible for creating a statue that defied the laws of physics? I think so, but let me know your thoughts in the comments. Keep in mind that this was the same guy who made the first vending machine, one of the earliest hydraulic machines, and a radial steam turbine engine.
Krishna's Butterball.
It's a giant chunk of butter that was stolen by the gods and dropped in India. It's still there to this very day, balanced precariously on the edge of a gentle slope. The chunk of butter is actually a rock, but it's called Krishna's Butterball. I think you're going to really enjoy the myth and mystery behind this huge rock.
I'll start with the legend before I ease into the mystery. In Hindu mythology, the major deity Krishna, eighth avatar of Vishnu, was a little baby. As an infant, Krishna was fond of stealing butter. One day, after Krishna stole some butter, a glob of it dropped down from the heavens and splattered in the earth realm. It then became a solid rock, so heavy that it will never move. Today, the petrified glob of butter is in the historical town of Mamallapuram, located within Tamil Nadu state. The history of the area is rich and exciting, and the butterball has been around for all of it. It's likely been teetering on the edge of the slope for at least 10,000 years, though nobody knows exactly how long it's been defying gravity. Locals have been obsessed with the butterball for centuries. If there was a giant rock in your neighborhood that looked like it was ready to tip over but never did, your whole community would be obsessed with it too. Locals used to call it the stone Van Irai Kal, meaning stone of the sky god. But in 1969, a tour guide came up with the much catchier name, Krishna's Butterball. You have to admit, it was a genius move. The catchy name undoubtedly increased tourism and the local economy. In the 7th century, King Narasimhavarman tried to move the boulder. There are no records saying why, but it's safe to bet he just wanted to do it for fun. He made a serious effort to roll the boulder down the hill, which looks like it should be really easy, but he failed.
In 1908, English Governor Arthur Havelock used a party of 7 elephants to try and yank the boulder down the hill, but to no avail. If a crew of elephants can't yank this thing over, it might never move.
On an even stranger note, the Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi and Chinese President Xi Jinping took a picture in front of Krishna's Butterball in 2019 holding hands. And no, it wasn't AI.
Why does this giant rock refuse to budge? It looks like the slightest push could knock it over the edge, but obviously that isn't the case. Scientists think the huge boulder got stuck where it is now during the Ice Age, but no one knows for sure.
The Shorya Megaliths.
The Shorya megaliths recently discovered in Siberia not only defy the laws of physics, but they also defy logic itself. Nothing of this immensity has ever been found before. The giant stones on Mount Shorya weigh over 3,000 tons each. That makes them the biggest hewn stones ever discovered in the world. Nobody knows how they were cut, transported, or what their purpose was.
Let me slow down and start from the very beginning. Trust me, you're going to want to hear every last detail. The Shorya megaliths are rock formations that are found within the larger area of Mountain Shorya in Russia's Kemerovo Oblast. The mountain rises to an elevation of around 4,000 feet. The megaliths form the ridge crests and summits of the mountain. When you look at them in pictures, or when you stand on the mountain itself and look up at the rock walls, you can clearly see each individual block. It looks as if the mountain was made from badly weathered Lego blocks. If you're familiar with the impressive ruins in Peru, such as Sacsayhuaman and Pumapunku, you'll notice the similarities here. The Shorya megaliths look like artificial walls made from huge cut stones. Scientists are divided on the matter. In the 1990s, geologists identified the rock formations as being natural. They said the stone blocks look the way they do purely by coincidence. The stone walls were formed by normal geological processes, including intense weathering and tectonic forces. Others, though not many if I'm being entirely honest, say the Shorya megaliths are all that remain of an ancient fortress, a stronghold that stood upon the mountain. Each brick weighs an estimated 3,000 tons, which is twice the size of the biggest stones from the ancient world found at Baalbek in Lebanon. As of now, there is no exact date for when the Shorya megaliths were created. If the fringe theory is true, whoever built the mountain fortress must have been an actual giant. There is no other explanation for how the builders transported the granite stones to the top of a mountain and then stacked them over 120 feet high. It would be like if all the stones at Stonehenge were magically piled on each other to form a wall. What technology could have accomplished this?
And now for a quick break, because it's shoutout time! I want to give a big thank you to the Allen Dykes and Aussie Lovin' Girl for supporting this channel. Thanks so much for letting us be a part of your day, and I hope it's a great one! Be sure to subscribe if you haven't already for more videos like this.
The Leaning Tower of Pisa.
Have you ever wondered why the Leaning Tower of Pisa leans the way it does? Is the old tower slowly tipping over? Is it an optical illusion? Or is the whole building just rebelling against physics?
Every day in the Piazza del Duomo, it's the same song and dance. Tourists pose with their hand outstretched towards Pisa's most famous bell tower, as if they were supporting it with their bulging muscles. We all have at least one friend who's posted the picture on social media. While everyone's seen the pictures, not everybody knows the secrets of the tower. It's famous today for reasons its original architects had not planned. In 1173, a white marble bell tower started to be built for the large cathedral complex in Pisa. It was supposed to be 8 stories tall, but by the time workers finished the third floor after 5 long years of work, the foundation had already started to settle unevenly. The ground in this part of Tuscany is mostly clay, sand, and shells. No, it is not ideal for building large structures on. The tower, before it was even done, was tilting dangerously. Maybe architects would have fixed it, but war broke out. Pisa went to war with Genoa, with both of these places being Italian city-states in the Middle Ages. The war lasted almost 100 years. During that time, the tower really settled into its lean. You might say it got a little too comfortable slouching. When chief engineer Giovanni di Simone tried to fix it in the late 14th century, he only made it worse. The following 600 years made the tower lean even more. By 1990, the tower was leaning 5.5 degrees, which doesn't seem like much, but is in fact a substantial amount of lean. Go ahead and lean yourself 5.5 degrees, and let me know how long before you topple over. In the 90s, the Italian authorities had to close the monument off to visitors and remove the bells so that engineers could stabilize it. While I would love to say the Leaning Tower of Pisa has a little touch of magic to it, that's just not the case. It isn't defying gravity, nor is it defying physics. The tower would have collapsed if not for modern intervention. scientists were able to add counterweights and reduce the lean to about 4 degrees. It should remain stable for another 200 years, or until an earthquake pushes it over. Rocca di Papa. Just a few miles from Rome is a road without gravity. Rocca di Papa is a small site situated on Lake Albano where the natural laws are always on vacation. Up is down and down is up, and water flows up the mountain instead of down it.
This is what the experts call an anti-gravity hill. They are all over the world, in India, Europe, and even America. It looks like an ordinary road moving through the beautiful woods beyond the smog of Rome, but it's really an optical nightmare.
The road has a gentle slope to it, looking like nothing out of the ordinary. But if you pour out your water bottle here, the water will flow up the slope instead of down it. When you walk down the hill, you can feel it in your body that the pavement is going up. The disassociation between what you're seeing and what you're feeling is incredible. It's something you just have to try at least once in your life. Scientists have come up with many theories over the years. It's been claimed that large metal deposits beneath the road cause a distortion in the gravity field. Volcanic activity has also been to blame. But as with other anti-gravity hills around the world, it's an illusion. Experts blame Rocca di Papa's power on something surprisingly simple. The effect is caused by a series of uphill and downhill lengths of terrain with no proper view of the horizon. If you close your eyes and walk the same length of road, you don't feel anything weird happening. The feeling of physics crumbling beneath your feet only happens when your eyes are open to view the optical illusion.
Have you ever been to an anti-gravity hill? If you have, be sure to let me know what your experience was like in the comments.
Flying saints.
Rocks and towers are not the only things that have defied physics through the ages. There is also a peculiar phenomenon which occasionally occurs in Christianity. The phenomenon involves flying saints. Saintly men who are suddenly endowed with the gift of flight and hover above the ground as if carried by an angel.
Francis of Assisi is the most notorious flying holy man. He was an Italian poet, mystic, and devoted Catholic. He was also the founder of the Franciscans, a powerful religious group that is still functioning today. Francis began his life as a beggar, grew into a preacher, and then started an entire religious order. There is no debating that he led a spectacular life, but if the rumors are to be believed, he also spent a lot of time flying around. Saint Bonaventure was born in 1221, 5 years before Francis of Assisi died. He had never met Francis, yet he wrote extensively about the Franciscan order and their founder. Many of his reports include stories of Saint Francis floating roughly 5 feet above the ground. Francis would sometimes reach the treetops, or he would shoot off into the clouds where he could hardly be seen. It was allegedly common knowledge that Francis had the gift of flight. Francis wasn't the only one. Alphonsus Liguori, Bishop of Sant'Agata dei Goti in the 18th century, was witnessed levitating during a prayer session at Foggia. He was also rumored to possess the power of bilocation. Bilocation means he could be in multiple places at the same time. People witnessed Alphonsus in two entirely different locations on the exact same day. It would be an incredible power to have. What would you do if you could be in two places at once? Many others have floated, including Simon Magus, aka Simon the Sorcerer. He was the mad sorcerer who tried to purchase his way into the apostles. He would have been the 13th apostle if Christ had allowed him to buy a seat at the table. Simon, annoyed that he couldn't be an apostle, performed magic tricks at the Roman Forum. To prove he was more powerful than Jesus, Simon flew high into the air. But Peter prayed to God to stop Simon's flying. Simon plummeted from midair and broke his legs. Seeing he was a phony, the crowd then stoned him to death while he lay crippled on the ground. Talk about an overreaction. Acoustic levitation. Science has proven levitation is 100% possible. In 2016, a group of scientists from the UK and Brazil lifted a polystyrene ball off the ground using sound waves. It was a huge win for science. Being able to lift something off the ground using nothing but sound has major implications for the future. What if humans could propel entire spaceships through the cosmos using sound waves? The experiment only involved a tiny ball, and it was only lifted the length of maybe a pinky nail, but it was still a big deal. With levitation being proved possible, does that now mean I can talk about acoustic levitation being used to build the pyramids? Because if a small polystyrene ball can be lifted using sound waves, surely stronger sound waves could lift larger objects. It could be that some of the greatest wonders of the ancient world were built using sound. The scientific team in 2016 used ultrasonic transducers to levitate the polystyrene ball. They arranged the transducers in a tripod formation, then flicked the switch. The transducers converted electric energy into sound energy, with the powerful sound waves negating the force of gravity. In even simpler terms, the sound waves canceled gravity and allowed the ball to float. 1,000 years ago, Arabian historian Abul Hasan Ali al-Masudi wrote about ancient Egypt. He focused a lot on the methods used by the Egyptians to build their greatest monuments. Abul claimed the Egyptians moved large stones using magic pieces of papyrus. The Egyptians would scrawl strange symbols onto what was essentially a piece of paper. That paper would be placed underneath a giant stone too heavy for humans to lift. Then a metal rod was struck against the stone, at which point it suddenly levitated off the ground. The stone would then be gently nudged along a path fenced by metal poles until it reached where it needed to go. The metal poles may have been kind of like the transducers used in the recent experiment. This may have converted energy into sound, allowing the stones to float near them using high-frequency vibrations. This could have theoretically worked, allowing stones to be swiftly moved from one place to another. Although I can't figure out what the magic papyrus was for, or how it added to the effectiveness of the sound waves, maybe the Egyptians had mastered both sound and magic. The Stonehenge Machine. The mystery of Stonehenge may have finally been solved. A carpet fitter from North Wales has built a machine that defies the laws of gravity. Stephen Tasker believes his machine could have been used by ancient druids to transport the building blocks of Stonehenge. This guy should get some sort of medal for his invention. At 66 years old, with no proper archaeological training, he may have solved one of the greatest mysteries in the world. For centuries, the greatest minds have struggled to understand how Stonehenge was built. Then Stephen comes along and blows their minds. Excavations and tests have proven that the stones used in Stonehenge's creation came from 180 miles away. The heaviest stones are up to 25 tons, making it tough to see how ancient people could have transported them through the wilderness. To give you an idea of what 25 tons feels like, try to pick up a school bus, a U-Haul cargo van, or a concrete mixing truck. Maybe the builders of Stonehenge used levitation technology like the brilliant Egyptians, or maybe they used an incredible contraption as a loophole to defeat physics. Stephen's machine is pretty weird, but it does work. I'll break it down piece by piece. The contraption uses a circular board balanced on planks and sitting on a pair of rockers and wooden feet. Stephen hasn't built a fully sized version because that would be expensive and difficult. But the small version he does have has already lifted almost a ton. Stephen started trying to figure out how to build the thing in 2004, but he didn't complete it until around 2018. You have to hand it to him, he's got perseverance. It takes a special kind of mind to spend over a decade building something to solve a mystery from 5,000 years ago, and without getting paid. The device works by supporting the weight of the stone on planks and moving the wheels using rockers. It's simplistic, yet highly effective. Engineer Sean Whitehead, an expert in ancient monuments, said Stephen's idea is as good as any and better than most. The hydraulics of the Alhambra. The Alhambra is perhaps the most famous and spectacular monument in the whole country, and for good reason. The Alhambra is more than just a monument. It's a lavish palace complex and an insulated city. It's the best surviving example of Moorish architecture in the world. It also boasts a hydraulic network that defies gravity. Part fortress, part palace, and part city, the Alhambra spans a whopping 26 acres. It has over a mile of imposing walls and is protected by 30 towers. The background of the great castle complex are some snowy mountains, and below is the Darro River. The oldest part of the structure is the Alcazaba, built as a fortress around the 9th century AD. Muslims, seeking refuge from a civil war, began building the walls of a stronghold to keep themselves safe. The Alhambra, as it stands today, wouldn't come into being until around 1238. Muhammad bin al-Hamar, the man who founded the Nasrid dynasty, discovered the ruins of the Alcazaba and went about establishing a new royal residence. It took many years, but the Alhambra grew into an amazing complex with a grand mosque, public baths, and much more. In 1492, the Alhambra came under Spanish control. King Ferdinand of Aragon and Queen Isabella of Castile ended the Nasrid dynasty and exiled the last Islamic occupiers from their borders. But what about those hydraulics? 1,000 years ago, the Islamic rulers devised a hydraulic system the likes of which the world had never seen before. They were able to raise water from the river far below the Alhambra into their palace. The water was sucked upward to where it squirted from fountains, sprayed in majestic arches, irrigated the gardens, and allowed everybody to have a bath. And what was more important 1,000 years ago than not stinking? The focal point of the hydraulic system was the Acequia Real. The canal drew water from the Darro River. It consisted of a dam, which diverted the river upstream. The river was split into different channels where water wheels lifted the water higher and higher. A series of hydraulic structures made of pools, pipes, and cisterns then distributed the water through the gardens and into the various rooms of the Alhambra Palace. This system might seem simplistic by modern standards, but it was the first step toward advanced engineering and the manipulation of water. People had been irrigating already for thousands of years, but the Alhambra elevated things to a whole new level of sophistication. The Hanging Pillar. The Hanging Pillar doesn't look like it has any business existing. It is one of the strangest pillars in the world because it appears to be levitating. There is a gap between the temple pillar and the floor that you can see clearly with your own eyes. You can even pass something thin underneath the pillar to prove it's not touching the ground. The physics-defying pillar is in Lipakshi, a quiet town in southern India. It's scenic and beautiful with a rich history going back thousands of years. However, the town is known for one very specific architectural marvel. The Hanging Pillar of the Lipakshi Temple has been baffling experts for decades. Let's take a tour through this ancient and remarkable sanctuary. It was built in the 16th century and dedicated to Lord Virabhadra. For those of you who haven't memorized all the Hindu gods, Virabhadra is one form of Shiva. He was created by Shiva's anger, and his wrath knew no bounds. He plucked out some eyeballs and did some other nasty things in the Puranas, which is a collection of old Hindu tales. Lipakshi Temple is covered in intricate carvings, which you can see here on the walls and various pillars that don't defy gravity. It has colorful frescoes and an awe-inspiring bull statue that stands 70 feet tall. You can walk through these halls yourself on a trip to India and feel as if you've been transported back in time. Despite the many wonders of the temple, people come here specifically to see the Hanging Pillar. It's located within the Grand Hall, an immense part of the temple supported by 70 strong columns. Each pillar holds a piece of the ceiling's incredible weight, but only one of them doesn't touch the ground, making it a little redundant. The gap between the pillar and the floor makes it appear as if it's floating. But what's the deal? Scientists say there is no deal. It was most likely seismic activity that caused the pillar to become detached from the floor, but it's still attached to the ceiling. Another possible explanation is that something went wrong during construction. The builders may have even done it on purpose, as a gag. 5 centuries later, and they're still laughing. The Oregon Vortex. In 1930, the Oregon Vortex and House of Mystery opened as one of the earliest roadside attractions in America. It was one of the first mystery spots that attracted tourists from across the nation. People flocked to the Oregon Vortex to behold the broken rules of gravity and physics. Balls roll uphill instead of downhill. Bubble levels don't make any sense. Tape measures are useless. And animals are supposedly freaked out too. The House of Mystery began life as an office and a storage building for tools. It was constructed in 1904 by the Old Grey Eagle Mining Company. It was in the late 1920s that mining engineer and geologist John Litster had the bright idea to develop the building as an attraction. It opened to the public a few years later. John dedicated himself to learning the secrets of the vortex until his death in 1959. He conducted thousands of experiments to understand how gravity could suddenly stop working. Even before the 20th century, Native Americans knew about the vortex. Legend has it their horses refused to enter the area, neighing and freaking out when they got too close. The natives listened to their horses and also stayed away from the vortex. They considered it forbidden ground, shunning the whole area. You don't often hear people talk about it. John ran thousands of tests, but they were largely pointless. Modern science has proven there is nothing paranormal or unexplainable about the Oregon Vortex, which, by the way, is located in Gold Hill, if you care to visit. The explanation is more psychological than extraordinary. The brain's visual processing centers are at fault here. The vortex is little more than an optical illusion. Do you know of any other sites or vortexes like this? Let me know in the comments, and be sure to subscribe if you haven't already. Rocamadour. Rocamadour has been called the most dramatic village in France. Feast your eyes on this beautiful ancient place, and you'll see why the name makes so much sense. Rocamadour is indeed dramatic, with the old buildings looking as if they should tumble off the edge of the cliff at any moment. The whole village is defying the laws of physics by not falling down. People have been living here since time immemorial, at least since around 20,000 BC. There is a prehistoric grotto not far from town that contains drawings of horses and deer made by cave people. There is also a monkey park where you can hang out with 150 Barbary macaques. The monkeys just sort of chill in the shade and wait for you to give them snacks. The monkey park has nothing to do with defying gravity or ancient history, but, you know, you guys should still know about it. The most historically important buildings in Rocamadour date back roughly 1,100 years. The beautiful Chapelle Notre Dame has been around since the 12th century. The statue of the Black Madonna, carved from the wood of a walnut tree over 800 years ago, draws visitors from across Europe who seek a miracle. It's said that before the Black Madonna performs one of its miracles, the iron bell inside the chapel rings on its own. Spooky, right? Another gravity-defying structure is the Basilique Saint-Sauveur, built in the Gothic style and backed snugly against the cliffs that overlook the town. In more ancient times, pilgrims would make the treacherous climb up the 216 steps to the sanctuary on their knees. Think about how hard it is to just climb 216 steps on your feet, huffing and puffing. Then imagine it doing it on your bare knees, no knee pads allowed. This was an act of penance, one that has been replaced in modern times by an elevator. The final building to remember is Rocamadour's castle. It was built at the top of the village to defend against invasion during the Middle Ages. Of all the buildings here that look like they could be shaken loose by the gentlest of earthquakes, the castle looks the most vulnerable. It's doing a balancing act on the edge of the cliff, making you wonder what the original architects were thinking. Whatever they had on their minds, I have to thank the architects for taking a risk and building this amazing castle. Its ramparts offer some of the most breathtaking views of the French countryside. It's a worthy stop on any trip to France, simply to visit the castle and wonder how gravity hasn't torn it down yet. The Kayaktiyo Pagoda. There is a fabulous pagoda in the Southeast Asian country of Myanmar that seems impossible to the human eye. Many believe it to be proof of the divine. Others label it as little more than a parlor trick. Take a look at the Kayaktiyo Pagoda for yourself and let me know what you think. The Kayaktiyo Pagoda is also known as the Golden Rock, which you can surely understand just by glancing at it. The rock looks like a huge chunk of gold with a pointy hat on it. The pagoda is a popular Buddhist pilgrimage site. It sits atop a tall hill in the eastern Yoma Mountains. The landscape is typically shrouded in dense clouds, making the pilgrimage feel like a trip from a fantasy novel. The journey would feel a little more special if it weren't for the crowds of people ogling at the impossibility of the Golden Rock. What makes the rock so impossible is its position on the edge of the hill, looking as if it's about to slip off.
It's at a weird angle, much like Krishna's butterball that I told you about earlier. The rock is 25 feet thick, seeming to teeter at the edge of an abyss. It looks like if you gave it a hard shove, maybe with a bulldozer, it would flip over the edge and shatter. On top of the rock is the pagoda itself, built on the very boulder. I think it looks like a pointy golden hat, but it's a really religious monument. According to the myth of Golden Rock, the pagoda was created 1,000 years ago when a king encountered a Buddhist hermit. The hermit was in possession of an extraordinary artifact. Inside his hat was a single strand of the Buddha's hair. The hermit offered the piece of hair to the king as a gift. In return, the hermit said the king should enshrine the hair inside a pagoda built on a rock the shape of his own head. It was a really weird request, one that I don't understand, but the king thought it was a good idea. The king just so happened to have supernatural powers. He inherited the powers from his father, who was an alchemist, and his mother, who was a dragon princess. With help from a magician, a rock that vaguely resembled the king's head was brought from the sea floor to the top of the mountain. The king balanced the rock at the very edge of the mountain, built the pagoda on top, and enshrined the strand of the Buddha's hair within. I can't testify to the legitimacy of the story since I wasn't around 1,000 years ago, but many people in Myanmar still believe its authenticity. Pilgrims come from across the country to light candles and leave offerings to the Buddha. As for the scientific reason behind the rock not falling, it's just really well balanced.
Thanks for watching! Be sure to stay tuned for extra content you might have missed!
Mysterious Ancient Tunnel. Archaeologists are constantly making exciting discoveries in the ancient Mesoamerican city of Teotihuacan, which is located near modern-day Mexico City. Some of their most fascinating finds in recent years came in 2014, when archaeologists ventured into a tunnel and came out with thousands of artifacts. Before the team went inside, the 340-foot-long tunnel had been sealed and left untouched for some 2,000 years. It was originally discovered in 2003, but it took 11 years for researchers to raise enough money to explore it. The entrance was covered with rocks, suggesting that it was sealed on purpose. As the archaeologists painstakingly worked their way through, they found statues, pottery, seeds, seashells, animal bones, and more. The site sits 59 feet beneath the Temple of the Plumed Serpent and is surrounded by the remains of hundreds of sacrificial victims. Near the tunnel's entrance, the team found a large offering that they suspected might be an elite person's tomb, but they did not come across any remains belonging to Teotihuacan's rulers. In a statement, excavation leader Sergio Gomez said that he still hoped to find human remains. This makes sense since the archaeologists had only dug about 2 feet into the tunnel by then, but there's been no news since about any royals being discovered. The burial place of Teotihuacan's leaders is a long-standing mystery, and the tunnel seemed like a promising location. Discovering these tombs would be incredibly helpful for learning more about the ancient city's history, especially since they left no written records behind. But the search is ongoing, and for now, experts have no choice but to work with the information they have when it comes to understanding the people who built and lived in Teotihuacan. New discoveries near Stonehenge. Earlier this year, archaeologists made several breakthrough discoveries while excavating near Stonehenge ahead of a road tunnel project in Wiltshire, England. The findings include Bronze Age graves, Neolithic pottery, and the remnants of a C-shaped structure that once stood at the site. Inside a 4,000-year-old burial, the team found a shale object that may have been part of a club or a staff. A baby was buried nearby with a beaker and nothing else. The C-shaped structure is surrounded by ditches that contain burnt flint, indicating that the ancient people who built the site used it for metal or leatherworking, or perhaps some other sort of trade. A collection of Neolithic pottery that the team found may have been left by the people who visited Stonehenge, or the builders themselves. Consultant archaeologist Matt Leavers told The Guardian that the artifacts show that people lived in the area over a several thousand-year span. He described the objects as traces of people's everyday lives and deaths, intimate things. Leavers also pointed out that each new discovery helps piece together a picture of what happened at the site throughout this vast time period. Many people oppose the road tunnel project because they believe it could interfere with the valuable ancient landscape and cause hundreds of thousands of artifacts to be lost.
Those in charge of the project have promised to go about it carefully and respectfully, but some say that it's not enough and filed a lawsuit challenging the plans. Plans to build the tunnel were recently suspended, perhaps giving archaeologists some more time to search for more evidence left behind by our Neolithic ancestors. How Stone Age people painted in the dark. The earliest human artists created a lot of paintings in caves, places that lacked natural light. Since people can't see in the dark, this begs the question of how they made their artwork. Archaeologists in Spain set out to solve this mystery by searching for evidence of how ancient humans may have made torches and lamps from wood and other flammable materials. After all, even the best artist needs to be able to see what they're working on. Study author Diego Garate said that charcoal remains at prehistoric cave sites were often overlooked by experts, but have a lot to tell us about how our ancestors created their images. Relying as much as possible on Paleolithic-era evidence, the team created their own torches and grease lamps. They made 5 wooden torches using a mixture of dried juniper wood, birch bark, ivy, pine resin, and deer bone marrow, and 2 grease lamps containing dried juniper wood, cow bone marrow, and resin. The researchers also put together a small fireplace with various types of bark and wood. Garate described the light that the torches and lamps created as different from modern-day artificial light. The torches burned for anywhere from 21 to 61 minutes. They were unpredictable, made a lot of smoke, and often had to be relit. The grease lamps, on the other hand, were useful for staying in one place, but not for moving through the cave, and the fireplace was smoky and burned fast. While the team can't say that they know for sure how Stone Age people lit up their workspace, they concluded that prehistoric humans were experts at navigating through caves. In fact, they were probably better at it than we tend to give them credit for, since moving through these environments is incredibly difficult, even with modern equipment. Sword Pyramid. While searching for treasure in Norfolk, England, an amateur metal detectorist named Jamie Harcourt discovered a gold and garnet sword pyramid that may have belonged to a wealthy lord or early medieval king. It resembles similar artifacts found at the nearby Sutton Hoo burial, also known as England's Valley of the Kings. The sword pyramid dates back to sometime between 560 and 630 AD. At the time, England was part of a kingdom called East Anglia. While sword pyramids are typically found in pairs, this one was discovered alone. Its owner may have lost it during their travels throughout the countryside. The pyramid measures less than 1/2 inch on each side of its base. There are 2 distinct designs on its 4 faces, which feature garnets that may have been imported from India or Sri Lanka. Helen Geek, who works for the Portable Antiquities Scheme as a finds liaison officer, told the BBC that the artifact speaks to the far-reaching trade networks that existed between Europe and Asia during the 6th and 7th centuries. She also said that losing one of a pair of sword pyramids is like losing an earring. How annoying is that? Interestingly, the sword pyramid was found in a place that is not a known archaeological site. These so-called stray finds are becoming increasingly common, according to PAS. Experts believe that sword pyramids were used for keeping weapons sheathed, but they don't know for sure. New human lineage. Over 7,000 years ago, an ancient woman from the Toalian culture was laid to rest with her knees drawn to her chest on the Indonesian island of Sulawesi. Her body and the sides of her head were adorned with large rocks from a nearby river. Indonesian archaeologists discovered the burial in a limestone cavern in 2015. Nicknamed Bese, the woman provided the first DNA from a period of early migration from Asia to Australia. She also bears evidence of an Asian lineage that experts didn't know about until now. The group appears to have entered southern Sulawesi after the first people arrived in Papua New Guinea and Australia, according to Adam Brum, who co-authored a study on the findings. Brum says that the Toalians were a fairly isolated group of hunter-gatherers who lived on Sulawesi from 8,000 to 1,500 years ago. Bese was 17 years old when she lived and died between 7,300 and 7,200 years ago. Her bones left no signs of injury, infection, or any other obvious cause of death. Bese is one of just 3 ancient skeletons from the region that scientists have managed to extract DNA from. Her DNA was badly degraded, and only 2% of her genetic information was retrieved from it. But it was enough to learn that she shared roughly 1/2 her DNA with indigenous Australian and Papuan people. This points to a possible wave of migration through the region among the people who were the first to arrive in Australia and Papua New Guinea. But the rest of Bessé's DNA comes from an unknown population that originated in Asia. Experts are unsure whether there are living descendants of this group or if it died out, but they do know that the woman's genetic information is unlike that of the people living on Sulawesi today. Viking amulet factory. In certain parts of Europe, including Denmark, England, and Russia, archaeologists have found ancient bronze figurines of long-haired women holding swords and shields. They long struggled to come up with an explanation for the artifacts, which date back over 1,000 years to the Viking Age. Researchers initially concluded that the amulets represented mythical warrior women called Valkyries, which the ancient Scandinavians believed carried fallen warriors to the afterlife. Archaeologist Peter Jan Dekkers and his colleagues recently challenged this theory, arguing that these small figurines represent real women who played important roles in Viking ceremonies. They also theorize that the artifacts are part of a larger collection of ritual objects that point toward complex gender roles in Viking Age Europe. The researchers cited the 2017 discovery of an early 9th century jewelry workshop on the western coast of Denmark as evidence. It appears as though Vikings used clay molds to craft bronze figurines at the site. In addition to producing Valkyrie amulets, the workshop made figurines of men and everyday non-mythical items like wheels and horses. Speaking with National Geographic, study co-author and archaeologist Sarah Croix said that the amulets do not necessarily represent warrior women. Instead, she suggested that the figurines convey blurred gender lines. For example, many feature women holding weapons and men pulling on their long hair. While these artifacts are still largely a mystery, in the ancient world there wasn't always a clear line separating the feminine from the masculine. Rare grave goods. While excavating an ancient burial mound in Russia's Kakassia Republic, archaeologists discovered the unusually well-preserved burial dating back 1,700 years. The grave belonged to a woman and one other person from the Tashtik culture. It contained organic objects that typically deteriorate over time, including items made from wood, bark, and cloth, so archaeologists were really excited. Pieces of a plaster mask that fell apart over time were found by the woman's skull. Scientists are currently trying to restore it. A decomposed doll discovered near her body contained the cremated remains of another person. The grave also contained a collection of goods, including vials, an ornamented barrel, an object resembling a small tub, and a mysterious object that archaeologists call the box. Mirage News reported that it could take years for experts to finish studying and running tests on the items, but they hope to learn more about the enigmatic Tashtik people. The culture lived in southern Siberia between the 1st and 7th centuries during the Iron Age. Their lifestyle revolved around agriculture and livestock, but little else is known about them. Underworld carvings. Around 3,200 years ago, someone who lived in what is now Turkey made a series of stone carvings of an ancient calendar and map of the cosmos. The artwork depicts what appears to be an underworld beneath the earth. While the artwork was discovered in 1834, experts only recently deciphered some of the 90 or so images, which include animals, gods, and mythical creatures. Drawings of sun and storm goddesses sit higher than other images, including depictions of the lunar and seasonal phases, a temple, and ordinary people. Images of the underworld, including dedications to the god of the sword, are found in a separate room. A recently published study claims that the artwork represents an ancient group of people's understanding of the universe, divided into the sky, earth, and underworld. The drawings also symbolize cyclical processes of birth and renewal, including the transition between day and night and summer and winter. Of course, only the people who made the artwork knew exactly what it meant and why it was important. Early monument making. Around 7,000 years ago, the people living in what is now northwestern Saudi Arabia built a series of stone structures known as mustatils. And they are much older and more complex than researchers originally thought, according to a study published earlier this year. A mustatil consists of a long rectangular courtyard with a platform at each end. There are over 1,000 of them, and they vary in size, with the largest measuring over 600 meters long and the shortest spanning just 20 meters. These mysterious monuments are spread over a vast 200,000-kilometer-squared area. Despite their size difference and widespread distribution, the mustatils share common features. In fact, their form is nearly identical from one to the next, according to archaeologist Melissa A. Kennedy, who spoke with the Art newspaper. She points toward these similarities as evidence of a shared religion in the region during the late Neolithic period. Some of the Muscatels undoubtedly required a lot of builders because they're so big. Because of this, the researchers think that they were created by a highly organized society or a group with common views and goals. The team found narrow entrances into the Muscatels' courtyards as well as circular stone cells. One site contained skull and horn fragments from cattle, goats, gazelle, and sheep. The pieces were deposited around a standing stone in what appeared to be ritual offerings between 5300 and 5000 BC, long before Stonehenge and the Egyptian pyramids were built. As fascinating as these discoveries are, they give us more questions than answers. Experts still don't know who exactly built the structures, why, or what specific deities the people worshipped inside the Muscatels. Kennedy admitted that these mysteries may never be solved, but that the research itself is nevertheless exciting. The Emerald Dial. In 1912, a group of workers in London made an extremely valuable discovery. They were demolishing an old building near St. Paul's Cathedral in Cheapside and got down to the cellar where they began hacking away at the bricks. Something glimmered and caught their attention. Turns out it was a wooden box chock full of treasure. There was jewelry, gems, and many other precious objects. It is now known as the Cheapside Hoard, and it is the largest known collection of Elizabethan and Stuart-era jewelry ever found. Consisting of nearly 500 pieces, experts believe the cache was hidden around 350 years ago, and more recent, in-depth studies have dated it to sometime between 1640 and 1666. The story goes that a gem dealer booked passage from the Orient back to England, bringing with him boxes and boxes full of gems. Someone saw him with a diamond the size of a walnut hanging around his neck, and then the next thing you know, he was poisoned. His treasure disappeared, but some of it ended up in the Cheapside Hoard. A curator at the Museum of London said that a jeweler or a goldsmith may have gathered the collection of jewels from all over and stashed the items before heading off to battle. Nobody knows who this person was, however. While it was relatively common for people to bury their valuables during that time, eventually they came back to get them. Upon debuting the collection's exhibit in 2013, the Museum of London described it as the single most important source of our knowledge on early modern jewelry worldwide. The items consist of jewelry made from material sourced from different continents, including Colombian emeralds, diamonds from India, and pearls from Bahrain. Included among the treasures are an emerald watch, a gilt brass watch, a Byzantine-era sapphire and pearl pendant, a gold pendant with sapphires, and much more. The emerald watch alone is considered priceless. Cut from an enormous emerald stone, the craftsmanship is incredible. Emeralds are delicate stones and fracture easily. Cutting into it and making a lid and engraving a clock right into it is incredible. But nobody knows who these incredible jewelers were, or the story behind who hid this incredible treasure. If only the pieces could speak. Sakwala Chakraya. Located in modern-day Sri Lanka, Anuradhapura, locally known as Rajarata or the Land of Kings, is an ancient sacred city and the island's first kingdom. Established in 377 BC, it remains a holy destination for Buddhist pilgrims from all over the world. Within Anuradhapura, at a 40-acre site called Ranmasu Uyana or the Golden Fish Park, there is a 6-foot slab that is said to contain the formula for unlocking the secrets of the universe. Known as Sakwala Chakraya, which is Sinhalese for universe cycle and nicknamed the Stargate, the artifact contains a collection of symbols that are widely interpreted to be a cosmological chart of some sort. Facing the suspected space map, there is a series of 4 seats carved out of rock. Archaeologists and historians have failed to explain the seats or the Stargate in rational terms. Speaking with the BBC, University of Kelaniya archaeology professor Raj Somadeva said that the items could date back to the 7th century, when the site's second major developmental phase began, but that the chart's origins, meaning, and function are completely absent from historical records, which are otherwise meticulous and thorough. This society kept good notes, but mentions of the Stargate are nowhere to be found. Conspiracy theorists and armchair detectives have suggested that the Stargate is a portal between Earth and outer space, and that ancient people used it for communicating with aliens, or that aliens were traveling to Earth to mine gold. Some have also connected the markings on the chart with similar symbols found at the ancient Egyptian site of Abu Ghurab and the Gateway to the Gods in Peru. Stargates are everywhere. Royston Cave. Beneath the town of Royston in Hertfordshire, England, is a man-made cave of unknown origins filled with enigmatic carvings. Measuring 17 feet in diameter and 26 feet high, its chamber is in the shape of a bell sunken into chalk limestone. It was likely once divided into two levels. The style of the medieval carvings covering the cave's walls has never been seen anywhere else in Britain, with the only known similar examples being in Israel and Czechoslovakia. This elaborate imagery, which is believed to date back to the 13th century, represents a series of biblical figures and scenarios, including the crucifixion of Christ and what appear to be depictions of St. Catherine of Alexandria, St. Lawrence, St. Christopher, and others. Experts can't seem to agree on who built the cave or what it was used for. One popular theory suggests that it served as a secret meeting place for the Knights Templar, or as an early Freemason lodge. Another idea proposes that the cave was built as a private chapel for Lady Rosia, the wife of William the Conqueror's steward. There are less far-fetched theories, including that Augustinian monks used the structure as a storage facility. As things currently stand, your guess is as good as mine. So who do you think built Royston Cave, and why? Let me know in the comments below. Graffiti crosses. The walls of the Church of the Holy Sepulchre in Jerusalem are covered in thousands of tiny crosses that, until recently, researchers believed were carved by medieval pilgrims, but they may have been misunderstood for years. A new study turned this theory upside down when it found that it was likely that just a handful of people, perhaps stonemasons or artists, covered the crosses for the pilgrims, and that the travelers kept the dust from the etching as a souvenir of the sacred site. Many of the crosses date back to the 14th and 15th centuries, several centuries after the Crusades, indicating that post-medieval pilgrims ventured to the site en masse. Study leader Amit Rahim noticed during a visit to the church that the crosses seemed to be expertly carved, challenging the long-held notion that they were put there by thousands of different people. He also saw a visitor trying to etch a cross into the wall, but security and church staff rushed right over to stop the person, making him wonder who in their right mind would have permitted pilgrims to make their mark on the wall hundreds of years ago. Using advanced imaging technology, Rahim and his team analyzed the crosses in intricate detail, right down to the chiseling techniques that were used to create them. Alongside the crosses, they noticed inscriptions containing names and dates, presumably indicating the approximate time periods during which the crosses nearby were inscribed. The study is admittedly inconclusive, with the carvings requiring further investigation to determine if they truly date back to the Crusades, and if medieval pilgrims kept the dust from the crosses. Mystery structure. While excavating a historic train station on the Asian side of Istanbul's Kadıköy district, archaeologists found the ruins of a marble structure covering mass graves. Located on the border between Europe and Asia, the structure is believed to have been sacred, but they don't know what it was used for, and the surrounding architecture offers no clues either. Found at the station's waiting platforms, the shape of the large structure was undoubtedly used for religious purposes. Yet researchers are confident that it was not a church, because nothing quite like it has ever been seen before. They believe they will find more answers as they continue to dig and uncover more artifacts and structures. Plus, the mass grave is something to be considered, but archaeologists don't seem too concerned about that right now. Excavations here began in 2018 when the station was closed for renovations and have yielded numerous fascinating finds from different civilizations that have lived there over the centuries, including a breakwater, two water reservoirs, and 18,000 coins dating as far back as the 7th century BC. A bustling trade center of the ancient world, the Kadıköy district was once home to a lavish Byzantine palace, but all it left behind were colorful mosaics and marble pieces. Archaeologists have also uncovered the remains of a 1,500-year-old church and a fountain dating back to the early Byzantine era. Unidentified stone head. Late last year, headlines detailed the discovery of a mysterious stone head at Shaftesbury Abbey in Dorset, England. Archaeologists were not only puzzled by the subject's identity, they were also unsure of the person's gender, owing to the combination of a seemingly masculine jawline and long, flowing hair of a woman, according to The Guardian. The head's nose, jawline, and several other facial features were missing, possibly from damage inflicted by a sledgehammer, further obscuring the subject's identity. Because the individual is wearing a crown, researchers know the statue likely represents a royal figure. Based on its estimated age, dating back to the 1340s, they surmise that the subject is King Edward II, who ruled from 1307 to 1327 after inheriting the crown as his father's only surviving son. Edward II's tumultuous reign was characterized by a Scottish defeat, being forced to surrender the crown to his 14-year-old son, and a suspected homosexual relationship, which was considered very taboo at the time. Upon being deposed, he was imprisoned and executed. The team that discovered the statue believes it may be part of a larger gallery of sculptures depicting royals that once stood at Shaftesbury. Founded in 888 by the Anglo-Saxon king Alfred the Great, the Abbey was England's first religious house exclusively for women. It thrived for centuries before being closed in 1539 under the order of Henry VIII, and thereafter fell into ruins. Archaeologists have admitted that they may never definitively establish the stone head's identity, but they are still trying. Giant mounds. A collection of at least 19 earthen mounds called tumuli, some measuring as high as a six-story building, have stood in Israel for over 2,500 years. Located in the suburbs outside Jerusalem, they are a daily sight to many locals, but nobody knows who built them or why. In an effort to get to the bottom of the mystery and in anticipation of the construction of a new housing development, the Israel Antiquities Authority recently conducted a thorough excavation of one of the mounds. Inside, they found the ruins of a building dating back some 2,700 years and several dozen stamped jar handles that they believe trace back to the Kingdom of Judah during the First Temple period. The team theorized that the site was an administrative center, but they are unsure why the biblical-era structure was buried, or if there are similar things hidden beneath the other mounds. Because the mounds are situated within close proximity to one another, some archaeologists think that their creation stems from a unified purpose. IAA Chief Archaeologist for Jerusalem Yuval Baruch explained that the amount of work required to build the mounds suggests that they were more than just garbage heaps or stones and earth that were cleared from nearby agricultural fields. A 1953 dig found a retaining ring wall with a set of stairs leading to a platform within, which was filled with burnt animal bones and evidence of fire. Israeli archaeologist Ruth Amiran speculated that the contents date back to the 7th or 8th century BC, and that the structure was a worship site that had been outlawed. Experts are skeptical of this theory, but lend some credibility to the idea proposed in 2003 that memorial ceremonies to the biblical kings of Judah were performed at the sites. Noting that nearly all the archaeological discoveries near the mounds are related to agriculture and administration, modern researchers have largely distanced themselves from religious theories, with some connecting the mounds to a nearby administrative center and palace that once served as a center for tax collection. Nebra Sky Disc. While hunting for treasure near the German town of Nebra in 1999, a group of metal detectorists discovered a 13-inch blue-green disc featuring a crescent moon, a sun or a full moon, and two gold bands, one which may represent the horizon. The finders heavily damaged the artifact while excavating it and attempted to sell it illegally. Swiss authorities caught them in an undercover sting in 2003, and the disc was subsequently turned over to the government that has jurisdiction over the area where they found it. Due at least partially to its shady past, tracing the object's origins has been a challenge for researchers, who initially dated it to around 1600 BC, which would make it roughly 3,600 years old. If this is accurate, it means the Nebra Sky Disc is the world's oldest known depiction of the heavens. But some scholars have challenged this proposed date, while others believe the disc is an outright fake. A recent study claims that the artifact is as much as 1,000 years younger than it was originally estimated to be, and argues that it lacks the deep meaning that researchers have attached to it. Much to the outrage of German society, the piece also asserts that the disc was not discovered anywhere near Nebra. The archaeologists who conducted the study believe that the disc dates back to sometime between 2,800 and 2,050 years ago, during the Celtic Iron Age, and that confusion between law enforcement and the people who found it have made it pretty hard to figure out where it really came from and what it means. Mysterious portrait. For centuries, a portrait of an unknown woman has graced the halls of England's royal homes, leaving researchers so baffled they've resigned to the possibility that they may never figure out who she is. Known as Portrait of a Woman, the painting in question is currently located in Mary, Queen of Scots' bedchamber at the Palace of Holyrood House in Edinburgh, Scotland. Last year, experts announced that they had finally identified the subject as Mary Boleyn, the older sister of Henry VIII's ill-fated second wife, Anne Boleyn. The painting is part of a 14-piece collection of specially commissioned portraits called The Beauties, which were likely created during the 1630s by Flemish artist Remigius van Leemput. Oddly, Mary's portrait features 16th-century clothing, while the 13 other subjects don 17th-century attire. This confusion caused the unidentified portrait to be separated from the rest during the 19th century. The team identified the painting by analyzing the age of its wood panel using a process called dendrochronology. The material came from a Baltic oak that was cut down sometime between 1651 and 1671, matching another previously unidentified portrait in the collection. Lead researcher and historian Justin Davies told the Tudor Travel Show podcast that the woman is indeed likely to be Mary Boleyn, but that one can never be 100% sure in art history because we are unable to stand at the shoulder of the painter when he's doing it. Thanks for watching! Remember to subscribe if you haven't already for more videos like these, and I'll see you next time! Bye!